It is amazing. Lord, you are awesome in this place. Open up our ears, please, Lord, Holy Spirit, that we can hear a word from heaven. Father God, I ask that you would help me to preach this message powerfully. Lord, I need your help to communicate what your Spirit has communicated to me. I acknowledge my humanity and my need for you. And so, Lord God, I just thank you that even though I am flawed, your word is not. So move through me powerfully, Lord, and I pray that you would open my mouth to say not only what I've planned, but unplanned prophetic words of the Holy Spirit to awaken our souls to you. In Jesus' name. If you love Jesus, shout a big amen.
Amen.
All right, today I am speaking to you on this topic, the most important question ever asked. The most important question ever asked. The reason why this is the most important question ever asked is this. How you answer this question will determine not only how you live the rest of your life starting right now, but it will determine where you spend eternity. If you have your Bible, please turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 16. We're going to be looking at a very, very famous and well-known and even, dare I say, controversial subject today as we open up to verses 13 to 19. Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 to 19. If you would you please stand in honor of the word of God today? The most important question ever asked, beginning in verse 13. The Bible says this, "Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, 'Who do people say that the Son of Man is?'" Who do people say the Son of Man is? "And they said, 'Well, some say John the Baptist. Others say Elijah. Others say Jeremiah or one of the other prophets.' Then Jesus flips the script on them and he says this, 'Who do you say I am?' Then Simon Peter replied," as he speaks for the group oftentimes, "he replied, 'You are the Christ.'" That means Messiah. That means Savior. "You are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Somebody say amen to that.
Amen.
"You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah." That means Simon, son of Jonah. Simon Peter's father's name was Jonah, his earthly dad. "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you." You didn't learn this from your earthly dad. You didn't earn this from some school, but my Father who is in heaven taught you this lesson. Blessed are you. Verse 18, "And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." How many of you know you're in the house of victory today? Verse 19, "I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Father, help me to preach this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. You can be seated. The most important question ever asked. You know, in school, some of you are teachers or retired teachers. No doubt, you've heard some, shall we say, interesting questions. Oftentimes, the questions may even be, shall we say, off subject, not in line with the lesson, or totally out there. Sometimes students will ask questions just to kill time in hopes that the bell will ring or the alarm will go off so that the teacher hasn't had time to pass out the homework. At least I know that's what we did when we were kids. I don't know if the kids today still do that. I don't want to cast dispersions on the next generation. But I know when I was a kid, if I could ask some questions to run out the clock, so to speak, it was a good day. You guys do that? Don't admit it in church. We'll have to pray later. Jesus was a master at good questions. This, in my opinion, is the most important one he ever asked. Because Jesus, oftentimes, if he was asked a question, he would answer with a what? A question. You know, maybe one of the biggest silent clues to the brilliance of Jesus, maybe one of the unsung gifts that we don't hear a lot about, was how intuitive Jesus was and how good of a listener he was. Jesus was a great listener because he didn't just hear what was being said on the outside. He heard the intention behind the question. And as he listened to questions, he would respond oftentimes with questions that would cause people in the room to think. So Jesus kind of warms the group up and he says, "Who do people say that I am?" And they offer a few answers. They say, "Well, maybe you're John the Baptist resurrected from the dead, and that's why you can do so many miracles. Or maybe you're one of the other prophets resurrected from the dead. Maybe you're the prophet that Moses talked about. Maybe you're this or that." And Jesus said, "Okay, that's fine and good. Let's just bring it home now. Who do you say I am?" How they answered this question mattered. How you and I answer this question still matters today. How you think of Jesus will impact the rest of your life on earth, and it will impact where you spend eternity. Every human soul will spend eternity somewhere. Jesus is creating heaven for us. Whether or not you punch your ticket to heaven is up to you. Hell is a very real place. Jesus never sends anyone there, but people choose to spend their eternity there when they refuse to answer this question correctly. The hell was not made for people. Hell was made as a place of punishment for Satan and his angels. We call those demons now. And anyone who chooses to turn their back on God's good grace and live life for themselves and not him, they are in essence telling Jesus, "No, thank you. I'm fine. I don't need you." And Jesus will not force anyone to come to heaven with him. But Jesus has gone through a lot of trouble and put his love on display for every single one of us. While we are still sinners, while we were born into sin, not deserving anything from God, Jesus demonstrated his love for us in this. He gave his life for us at the cross. Not only did he die, but he was buried and 3 days later rose from the dead, proving that he is who he said he is. Jesus is not some good teacher, not some religious leader, not some prophet, because these religious leaders that other religions follow never claimed to be God. Jesus did. So either Jesus was a lunatic or he's Lord of all. There's no in between. I don't want to follow somebody who claims to be God when they're not. And when the resurrection happened, even the earthly brothers of Jesus Christ, those who did not believe in him before the resurrection, we see it in the book of James, the earthly brother of Jesus. He is absolutely convinced that his older brother is God. What would your older brother have to do to prove to you that he's God? James knew Jesus for his entire life, and yet something happened after the cross that proved to him, this isn't just my brother, this is God in the flesh. The resurrection shifted everything. If Jesus came up out of that grave, then we owe him everything. If he's still there, let's just go home. How we answer this question matters. So let me just talk about a couple of contextual things here just to kind of set the backdrop. Verse 13 says this: when Jesus came to the district of Caesarea Philippi, he gave them this lesson. This is important. Jesus never did anything by accident or randomness. He picked this city on purpose. Caesarea Philippi was a polytheistic pagan place. They worshiped multiple gods, countless gods, lowercase g, false gods, idols. This had become a great place if you wanted to worship Caesar. There was lots of emperor worship happening here. And they had a cave, and the cave is still there to this day, that they genuinely believed was the entrance to the underworld. It's a very eerie place, actually, if you Google the picture of the gates of hell in Caesarea Philippi. There is a giant cave that they literally believed that if you walked far enough down that cave, you would enter hell. It's against that backdrop that Jesus declares those words, the gates of hell will not prevail, not be able to destroy or come against that which I am building. There is absolutely no authority that Satan has in our lives unless we give him a seat at the table. What Jesus is building and continuing to build will never, ever be destroyed. There is no demon in hell, and not even Satan himself could keep Jesus in the grave. He's alive, he's well, and so's his church. Somebody give him praise right there. How will you answer this question today? Those who are able to answer this question correctly are blessed. I love it when Jesus looks at Peter and says, "Blessed are you, Peter. You're blessed." Now, Jesus is not conferring a blessing on Peter. He's simply stating a fact. He's revealing the condition of Peter's heart. When we answer this question correctly, everything else about our lives comes under the blessing of God. When we invite Jesus into our hearts and we make him the Lord of our lives, that means the owner. That means he is the director of every step we take from now on. When we come into that kind of relationship with God, we're blessed. Period, end of sentence, and nothing can change the fact that you're blessed and on your way to heaven. Friends, you could have everything that this world has to offer. Success, money, relationships, contacts, fame, fortune, the big house, the nice car, it all. You could just have it all. But what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and yet lose his soul? When you have Jesus in your life, you might be going through a rough time. Guess what? You're blessed. You might be going through a difficult season. Guess what? You're blessed. You might have lost your job and you're going through a time of confusion and doubt. Guess what? You're blessed. You might not be able to eat out as much as you used to eat out or go on all the vacations you used to go on, or things might be a little rocky in your relationships. Things might not be panning out the way you had hoped when you were 20 years old and you look back over your life and you've got a few regrets. But if you've got Jesus, friends, you're blessed and nothing is going to change that. You're blessed. Why are you blessed? Because your ticket is stamped and you're on your way to heaven. And when I get to heaven, I'm going to enter a joyful reward, an eternal reward. My reward is Jesus. He is my inheritance. And when I come into his presence, nothing that I experienced on earth will even come to mind. It will all fade away to some forgotten past, and I will look forward to an eternal future with Jesus. Hallelujah. He is my inheritance. That's why I can go through hell on earth. Guess what? I'm blessed and nothing Satan throws at me can change that when I answer the question correctly. If you know it's true, shout a big amen. Amen. I also want to point out that if you've answered this question correctly, you had some help. Look at what it says. It says, Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven." So I love how Jesus is just amazing. He is brilliant. When was the last time you considered just how brilliant Jesus was? I mean, he's nobody's fool. And he says everything on purpose.
And he's making this interesting connection because I can imagine, I mean, this isn't in scripture, but I can just imagine based on other moments in scripture that Jesus asks the question, and then the disciples, like Peter's like, huddle up. What do y'all think? What's he saying here? Okay, good. John the Baptist, what do you think? Jeremiah, one of the other prophets, okay. All right, anybody else want to throw it in? Hey, we better say he's the Christ. He's the Son of the living God, okay. And Peter turns around and says, survey says. Here's what other people are saying to you, but here's what we think because we've watched you in action. We've seen how you deal with people. We've seen how you deal with the religious crowd and how you put them in your place. And when you speak to them, you don't speak as one of the other scribes. You speak as one with authority. And we see how you speak to the demon-possessed. And the demons must leave when you tell them to leave. And we see how you bring us back to a center on the Word of God and the original intentions of God's heart when it comes to the Bible. And you help us to understand that it's not just about what we do on the outside, but it's our heart. And we see you raise up those who are lame, and you open blind eyes and deaf ears, and you do these miracles, and no one else could do that. You must be the Son of the living God. But this is an answer that no one answers this question correctly without the help of God. Peter had an earthly father. His name was Jonah. But what is Jesus referring here? He's saying, look, Peter, you've got an earthly dad, and I'm sure he was a good guy. Taught you how to fish, taught you how to make a living, taught you how to fix nets, taught you how to repair the boat if it had a leak, and taught you how to support your family and be a good, faithful dad and husband. But you're not getting this answer by Jonah. Jesus says you're blessed because his name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and he has a heavenly Father who is involved in the process of helping us get this question correctly. If you get this question correct, you've had some help. Now, in college, I loved it when at the beginning of the school semester, if a professor passed out the study guide for the final at the very beginning. We had teachers like that. They made it their goal to take the anxiety of a midterm or a final out of the question so that they could actually spend class time with an anxiety-free class, a fear-free class, so that the students could actually just hone in on the lectures and the lessons and the prayer. And they just kind of helped us. They said, here's the midterm final. Here's the questions that are going to be on it. Here's where you can find the answers. These are the parts that are open book. These are the parts that are open Bible. If you will just look at this a few times before the midterm, you're going to do great. Now let's have class. And I never failed those tests. Never. Why? I had some help. They made it easy for me to find the answers. There are some things in the Bible that are confusing. I could go through a long list. I won't waste your time. No doubt if you've read the Bible at any point in time, you've probably come across a few passages that made you go, huh, I wonder what that means. This is the one question that really matters. And God made it so clear that none of us could have an excuse. The only way to heaven is through Jesus Christ, period. I'm glad that God was very very clear so that none of us get the test wrong. And I know that's not politically correct. I know the world hears us say that as Christians and they think hateful, they think bigot, they think all kinds of things. But when I hear that Jesus is the only way to heaven, I think, wow, God gave me the study guide in advance. He's helping me to know the answer because he wants everybody to know the way. He wants everybody to know the truth. He wants everybody to know the big answer to the big question is Jesus. He is the Son of the living God. He's the way, he's the truth, he's the life, and he's the only one in any religion that ever said, I am who I am, and I'm gonna prove it. I'm gonna die, I'm gonna give my life up, and then I'm gonna raise my life up, and you're not gonna have any excuse whatsoever, because you're gonna see me die, you're gonna see me get buried, you're gonna see me get up out of the tomb, you're gonna see me go up in the clouds of glory and seated at the right hand of God. A few days later, I'm gonna give you a deposit guarantee called the Holy Ghost, and it's gonna show you that there's more to come. Friends, we've got no excuse. It's Jesus, and Jesus all the way. If we answer this question correctly, we had some help. Look at what it says in John 6:44. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws them, and I will raise them up on the last day. What's he saying there? He's either going to raise you up out of the grave, or he's going to take us up in glory in an event called the rapture of the church. And by the way, that's happening very soon. The next event, I love what Brother Tiff Shuttlesworth said last week. I mean, it was a wonderful message. He said, the next event on heaven's calendar is the rapture of the church. That means he is going to take the church out of this world miraculously. And the Bible says, in a moment, faster than your eye can blink, with the sound of a mighty archangel, the church is going to be called up into the air with the Lord. And those who died in Christ are going to be there, and we're going to be there. And then the next 7 years on this planet will literally be a merger of hell and earth. And you don't want to miss the first train, my friends. Don't want to miss the first train. Yeah, or, you know, you can read the Bible, and it seems to indicate people get saved during the tribulation. I want to go up in the first train. There's no need in you missing that train. How do you get there? How do you make sure you go up on the first round? Get this question right. And by the way, we have some help. Jesus is making the answer really clear. Lastly, those who get this answer right receive spiritual authority. Now, there's a lot of debate about Peter. Upon this rock, I'll build my church. There's entire movements out there. The Catholics feel one way about this passage. Protestants feel another. There's all kinds of thought and different things. I'm not going to get into all the minutiae of the debate surrounding this, because I believe that oftentimes Scripture will interpret Scripture, and the simplest answer is right in front of us. A lot of people want to debate various things because they have agendas. Right? They have agendas. And it all comes back to either money or power. Yep. And so I'm not going to fool with the agendas, and I just want to try and dig into what the Scripture is actually saying here. So let's just read it together. You'll notice here, it says, and I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. What did Peter just say? You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. Friends, that's the gospel in a nutshell. Amen. You get that right, you're on your way to heaven. On this rock I will build my church. The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. How powerful must this have been? I mean, I don't know exactly where Jesus was sitting when he had this lesson, but I just have to believe that that cave was somewhere in view. And it wasn't an abandoned tourist attraction like it is today. In their time, the sounds and smells and sights of paganism would have been in their hearing. They would have heard people cutting themselves. They would have heard people screaming. They would have heard the sounds of cult prostitution. They would have smelled the incense burning to the false gods and the songs that they had written to Caesar. All in the background, it would have been a very intimidating and freaky sight. And Jesus says, look, all of this, this cave, these people, these false gods, none of it has anything on you when you're a part of my church.
The gates of hell will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom. How do we get into the kingdom? It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? For whosoever will believe on the Son of the Lord will not perish, but have everlasting life. And God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but through him the world will be saved. It's the gospel. And anybody who raises their hand and says yes to Jesus, they've got a key to the kingdom, a key to a mansion with their name on it, crowns of glory they're going to throw down at Jesus' feet, an eternal reward, eternal responsibility, an eternal purpose, all for the glory of our King. Somebody shout hallelujah. That gets me excited. The keys to the kingdom are the confession. You want to make your way into heaven? Confess Jesus as Lord. Get the answer right to the question. You will receive spiritual authority. Watch this. It says, I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth. What do you do with a key? You can lock things up or you can let things go. Now, oftentimes we see this and we think in terms of spiritual warfare. Binding and loosing in the heavenlies and so on and so forth. We've seen all kinds of good teaching on that and unfortunately not good teaching. And so many times we think in terms of loosing and binding in various ways. And so here's what I want to challenge us to think about today. One application of this would be to bind the scriptures to our hearts. Remember when the psalmist said that? Bind the scriptures on our hearts. Bind it. Affix the scriptures to your mind and your heart. Affix the scriptures. Bind the scriptures. Lock them in to your life. When you have the Bible locked in, your life is let go. Your life is free. Your life is loose. If we have the scriptures locked in, our life is free. Someone say amen. Amen. Now, oftentimes we think of binding demons and binding Satan, and we hear that all the time. Let me tell you something. I don't want Satan bound to me. I don't want him anywhere near me. I know the Bible says take thoughts captive and make them submit to the truth of the word of God. So the enemy pushes and pushes. We taught on this on Wednesday night. The enemy pushes and pushes. How does he push us? He pushes lies on us. Here's what he says. He says, you're not enough, you're not smart enough, not good enough, you're not holy enough, you don't have enough, you'll never be enough. So he pushes these lies on us, and oftentimes we just let it happen. We just let him push all over us. How do you push back? It says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. What does that mean? It says, push back when the devil pushes you. How do you push back a lie? You push it back with the truth of God. That's what it says. When you have a thought that comes through your head and it's not a good thought, you bind it, take it captive, and you make it submit to the truth of God's word. Then guess what do? You kick it out. Oftentimes, Jesus would look at someone demon-possessed, and he would say, thou art loosed. He had the authority, he had the keys, and he loosed the woman or the man from their bondage. What did Jesus just give to Peter? A commission to be a pope? No, not to be offensive. But I think God gave him actually something much more. Did you hear what I said? More than a position of an earthly kingdom. He gave Peter the gospel. And anyone who hears the gospel has the potential to be set free from every single sin, to be set free from the effects of sin and the bondage of sin, to be set free from the lies that Satan has to offer. And we have the ability to live in the truth and in the light of God's word. If we remain in the vine and he in us, you will ask what you will and it will be done, the Bible said. There's authority. When you know who you are in Christ, what is it that we get when we answer this question correctly? We get the keys. What do keys represent when the Bible talks about Jesus going into the depths of hell and taking the keys of Satan from him and the keys of the grave and the keys of hell, and he comes out of there like a champion of heaven, having knocked the devil down, and he says, I've got the keys. What does that mean? all authority in heaven and earth kind of keys.
Authority. And what are we when we come to Jesus and we get this question right? We are grafted into the family, adopted into the family. We're heirs to the kingdom. The keys in the hands of Jesus. The gospel. You have the keys of the gospel in your words, in your actions. And you have the ability in your prayer life to pray the enemy away.
Yes.
To pray the enemy off your kids, off your husband, off your wife, off your mom and dad, off your aunts and uncles, off your cousins and coworkers, off the people you work out next to at the gym. You're walking in with a lot of authority. It's time for the church to use it. We have the authority to pray over Washington, D.C. We need to pray more. Hallelujah. We have the authority to walk into the public school system and pray. We have the keys to that school. We have the keys to DC. We have the keys to revival. And when you pray and when you push back, the enemy has to flee. Why? Because you have the keys, not him. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. We are accessing heavenly authority through our prayers and through the use of the gospel, the message. What is the message? Jesus is the one and only living, powerful, almighty, and resurrected Son of the living God. The most important question ever asked. Sarah, would you come and play something softly, please, hon? What is your answer? I used to hate it when teachers would give us a test and there was like three questions on it. You get one wrong, man, you get two wrong, you're lost. I used to love it when teachers would give us a test with like 100 questions and they're all worth 1 point, you know, because you get a few wrong, you're still doing okay. Well, Jesus has given us a test, and there's one question, and it's a pass or fail. Lucky for you, and lucky for me, he gave us the study guide. You hear what I said, church? He gave us the study guide. He gave us the answer to the test before we even have to take it. So if we fail, you know what my professor would say if we fail the midterm or fail after he had given us the study guide? He would say, well, that's your fault. I gave you the answers at the beginning of the semester. Friends, we got one question on the test. He gave us the study guide and made the answer real clear. It's Jesus or nothing. And I'm really glad that he made the test really simple. Would you bow your heads and your hearts with me in prayer? Father God, in Jesus' name, I pray for all listening today. I pray that everybody in this room and everybody watching online would answer as Peter did. But they can't do that unless they have some help. So Holy Spirit, we pause. Draw us closer to you today. Who do you say Jesus is? As some have said, he's either Lord of all or not at all. There's no in between, there's no middle ground. There's no second place. You either get this question right or you get it wrong. And that's not hateful, that's love. Because it's impossible to get this question wrong unless you just choose to ignore the answer. It's Jesus. Anyone who calls on that name
will be saved. Who do you say Jesus is? Father, I ask in Jesus' name that everyone listening today would exit this church without any doubt that Jesus is the Lord of all in their life. How many of you would say today, Jesus is Lord of my life? Just lift up a hand. Come on. If Jesus is the Lord of your life, everybody, hallelujah. I'm looking at 100%, I think. Almost 100%. Hallelujah. Well, if you don't have your hand up right now, friend, there's no reason to get this question wrong. Let's all pray together. Let's all pray together. And I want you to apply your faith to this prayer and invite Jesus to be the Lord of your life. If he's not first place in your heart, let's get that right. Right now. Say this with me, church. Heavenly Father, I put my faith and my hope in your Son, Jesus Christ, and the door of my heart is wide open. Come in and have relationship with me. I give you my past, my present, and my future. I am yours in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on, let's stand to our feet. Let's lift our hands. Let's give God praise. Hallelujah. Come on, he is in charge today. He is the Lord today. Hallelujah. We got the answer correct because Jesus has helped us. Father, bless your people today and help us to live our entire lives in the knowledge of your Son Jesus, that every single day of our lives would be lived in this truth that Jesus is Lord of all. If you agree, would you say amen? Amen. Give the Lord a big praise right there. Would you do me a favor and be seated just for a moment more? Cindy's coming to help us close out the service with a few highlights. Some really exciting things are coming, and also to help us to receive our offering.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. I just have a few highlights as we are closing, and things that you need to be aware of. So if you'll just give me a few moments of your time. I want to remind you regarding your tithes and offerings. So if you brought those with you, you can give via check or cash or credit card through the envelope in the pew in front of you, or you can also give online. Those of you watching online at nprassembly.org/donate. And we thank you so much for your giving and remembering your tithes and offerings. If you're a first-time visitor with us today, we invite you to fill out a connection card, which you will also find in the pew in front of you. And then as you exit, if you will put that in one of those black receptacles or leave it with an usher, we would love to follow up with you and welcome you to our church family. Before I move on, I want to remind everyone that we did take communion, and if you do have things that need to be thrown away on your way out, if you would please take those with you. We really appreciate that, and I know that our cleaning staff also really appreciates that. Next Sunday, June 13th, we will be holding a water baptism during our main service. I think I have seen like 7 or 8 people so far signed up for that. Praise God. We are so excited about next week and the water baptism. So if you have made Jesus Lord and Savior of your life and you want to take the next step and be water baptized, we invite you to sign up for that right in our main lobby as you're exiting today. On Friday, June 18th, Women's Ministry will be meeting at 6:15 p.m. right here at the church to leave for an evening at Sunset Beach in Tarpon Springs. So if you need a ride, please be here at the church at 6:15 p.m. to carpool over. Bring your own snack pack, beverage, and bug spray. Come out for a beautiful evening of fellowship and learning and sharing from our hearts. In case of rain, the location will be changed here to the church. But if you have any questions about that, you can see our Women's Ministry Director, Natalie Bracero, who's sitting right there. Choir rehearsals have begun. Hallelujah. Raise your hand if you are part of the choir. Wonderful. We are having, the choir is going to be making a special presentation for us on July 4th, and they are beginning to prepare. There's 2 rehearsal options, as you'll see on the screen. One takes place every Monday from 6:30 to 8 p.m. and the other every Tuesday from 1 to 2 p.m. right here in the fellowship hall, which is to my right, your left. And whether you have been involved in the choir or not, we invite you to come out and become a part of the choir. Amen? We're very excited about that. I don't know about you, but I am happy that I came to church today to praise the Lord, to hear from his word. Aren't you so glad? And so I just want to send you out with a blessing, that the Lord would bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you. Amen? And all that you do and all that you say, and just as Pastor was saying, that we would spread the word, we would spread the gospel throughout our workplaces and in our families. And so we pray that over you today. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. God bless you as you go.
Son of God, you are the one. grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. And we lift high the name of Jesus. So yes, and we will sing, sing.